Entrepreneurially Thinking is a presentation of BioSTL and CET, Center for Emerging Technologies, with RareGem Productions, changing the way you view new ventures, including you, on the pathway to success with your business in the St. Louis marketplace and beyond. Here's your hosts, Cheryl and Christy. Now let's get thinking entrepreneurially.
Welcome to the Entrepreneurially Thinking Podcast. We're here to ignite your entrepreneurial mindset and discover pathways for business success in the St. Louis marketplace and beyond. I'm Christy Maxfield, Director of Entrepreneur Development Services at CET.
And I'm Dr. Cheryl Watkins-Moore, Director of Bioscience and Entrepreneurial Inclusion for BioSTL.
We're stepping out of our comfort zone and asking you to step out of yours with us to get you thinking about your business in an all new way. We want to take the constraints off of how you view new ventures. So what have you been up to lately?
Man, this has been like a great season. I want to celebrate that. Thanks to all of our listeners, guys. You're making this podcast a huge success. Thanks to RareGem Productions, as well as Christy. We're having a great time here, and want to welcome you guys for our second season here.
We always want to hear from you, so please subscribe and rate your episodes so that we have the opportunity to share with more and more people. It's easier for them to find us when you tell them how much you love us. Mm-hmm. So today we're going to do a sweet introduction to an entrepreneur who went from mortgage banking to milk chocolate. We're going to take a quick break and come right back and start our conversation with Sharon Echols.
This is going to be such a great episode.
Now here's Make It Happen with Keith Sales Pro.
As an entrepreneur, I've learned these four things that no one tells you about entrepreneurship. Number one, there is a sense of isolation that is really profound. We're all used to being part of a reference group. When you're an employee of an established business, you have colleagues. When you're in college, you have classmates. Number two, most businesses provide a lifestyle and a job, but they don't provide wealth. For example, most restaurant owners probably take home an income that is not much greater than that made by a restaurant manager at a popular chain. Number three, it usually takes many years to build a business. I've run several businesses in my lifetime, very simple businesses, moderately simple businesses, and very complicated businesses. Number four, you have to manage people. When running a business, you're constantly managing not just employees and vendors, but customers as well. If you love what you're doing and you like business, being an entrepreneur could be a great thing. It's certainly good for the country, but recognize that it may not live up to the picture painted in the popular media.
Today, remember, it can happen. It will happen. And together, we will make it happen.
Follow Keith Sales Pro on Facebook or Twitter at Keith Sales Pro, or visit his website at KeithSalesPro.com.
It can happen. It will happen. And together, we will make it happen.
My name is Brandon Walker, owner and operator of Positive and Productive Innovations. Entrepreneurship to me is building your own brand, working diligently, and sacrificing all for yourself and your last name and your family's legacy and lineage.
I told Christy, I found this entrepreneur in one of our newspapers here that highlighted her in the character.
Business Journal, right?
Yes, that highlighted her in the character section. And I was just so impressed with her business and what she was doing. I said, we have got to get her here on our podcast. So I'm so happy.
Yeah, you went old school. Here. You ripped it out. You put it in your notebook. You carried it around. And then every time we had a chance to talk about it, you took it out and smoothed it out and made sure that we got
and
to
And I said, we're getting her on this show.
And so. We did. And we're really excited about that.
Yes.
To get the conversation started, we want to introduce you to Sharon Echols. She's with Miss M's Candy. She's going to share with us how she found her sweet spot and built her business.
And I think what's so exciting before Sharon speaks is that her business steps outside of our comfort zone from the perspective. It's not one of these high-tech, you know, Boeing type of adventures. But what I really love about her business is she started her business with a concept, and now she's in business and scaling it and growing it to serve a different location here in our city. So we're really proud about what she's doing. going. So without further ado,
Sharon, welcome to Entrepreneurially Thinking.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us. So tell us about your story. We know you today as the proprietor of Miss M's Candy, but you were doing lots of things before you decided that you wanted to tempt everybody's sweet tooth in the loop. So tell us a little bit about how that all started, when you started thinking about becoming an entrepreneur, and what led to actually opening a storefront.
Okay, so I've been in the mortgage industry for over 25 years, and we knew that the industry was changing a little bit, so we wanted to make sure we had something to fall back on in the event that we got laid off.
Now, who is we?
We is my husband and I.
Okay.
Lee and Sharon Echols, and we opened up this business with our family. So I can remember being downstairs on the treadmill, and it's this show that came on called The Big Idea. I don't know if you guys ever heard of that.
Yes, I have.
With Donnie Dorch. I used to watch that all the time. So I would hear about all these ideas of people trying to come up with these different entrepreneurial or businesses that they wanted to do. So with that in mind, I was thinking, you know what, we can maybe open up a candy store. It would be something fun. It would bring candy back into the neighborhood, you know.
And that's what's so intriguing. Why did you think candy of all things?
Because I wanted something that will impact all age groups. You know, people from as little as one all the way up to 100 love candy at some sort.
Most definitely.
So then what, you never saw candy stores or shops in neighborhoods anymore, because now you have the Walgreens, Walmarts, and things like that.
Yeah, you can get it anywhere.
Yeah.
I remember growing up and going to the candy store, especially our church was on one corner and the candy store was on the other, and guess where all the kids were?
But aren't those fond childhood memories?
Yes.
Yeah, so you didn't see that much today. So I told my husband, like, you know what, let's open up a candy store. He was like, no. I'm like, I said, no, listen, hear me out. It won't be your traditional candy store. We'll do a candy store in a neighborhood that has both tourists and neighborhoods, you know, homes where kids alike can come, but also an area to where it brings a lot of people to it.
So a destination area.
A destination. So that's why we decided on the Delmar Loop. But we surveyed that whole area for a whole year. We drove down there every day just to kind of get a feel for what the foot traffic was like.
Wow. So, you did on-the-ground market research.
I was just about to say that.
Instead
of just opening it up, you got some background. You guys were looking at, you know, the type of traffic, the demographics. That's what we try and tell our young entrepreneurs when we engage them. You got to do your homework, right?
Location is key. Yeah, you can't just open up anywhere. You need to make sure you're in an area that has that foot traffic. So we have the foot traffic of the tourists, and then we have Washington University over there as well, so we get the students. And then you have businesses over there also.
And was there any other store that was similar to what you guys were offering in that neighborhood or close
to?
No,
actually, we were the first ones in that building right there at the corner of Delmar and Skinker for at least 3 years before you had other businesses moving in.
And you said you kind of read the market. As a mortgage banker, you knew things were changing.
Yeah.
And how long before that change, or what helped you pull the trigger?
So we were thinking about this. It was the latter part of 2009, January 2010, I got laid off
from
my job. So, you know, it was very disappointing. You knew it was going to happen, but you always think that it's not going to happen to you. Well, and then right when all that occurred, the next day I ended up having major surgery. So that kind of set me back a little bit. But during that time I was off, you know, I was looking for another job, but also working on trying to open up a business, because I'm like, this is the perfect opportunity to do it now. So that's when we decided to go ahead and go forward.
So you said you and your husband, when was your husband also in the mortgage banking industry?
And he still
too,
is
as well?
Today.
Okay. So you had someone that was still kept their day job, right? And allowed you to do the business plan and do all the background and the market research.
Yes.
That's very interesting. I mean, that's where a lot of times we've talked to entrepreneurs, you know, and we tell them, you know, you don't have to quit your day job to actually live out your venture and live out your dream. And if you have a partner that can allow you to do that full time, that's even better. So
I think that's where a lot of people make mistakes, is that they start a business and they want to quit their job. Well, unless you have that financial support, I wouldn't recommend that right off the bat. Because you just never know what to expect. I mean, there could be a change in the economy or anything.
Yes.
But during that time that we opened, we knew that confectionery profits were growing. That's a very large market, and I don't think anyone really realized how large the market is. But as you can see today, 6 years later, you're seeing little candy and convenience shops appearing in a lot of places throughout St. Louis.
So you guys kind of paved the way in the market in St. Louis. That's really exciting.
I kind of think so, because you didn't have that before. And so we take it as a compliment.
Excellent. I love that you take it as a compliment, because that means you've inspired others, and you don't necessarily see them as competition then, because you feel really good about where you've positioned yourself in the market.
Yeah, I don't really see them as competition, especially if they're not in the same area that we are. I mean, it's enough candy to go around.
But I think you're unique. Why don't you tell us about your offering that you have at your candy, at your store in the Loop?
Okay, so what we wanted to do is, when we decided to open up this candy store, is to be unique, like you said, but we wanted to offer all things candy. So not only did we offer a large variety of candy, such as chocolate, taffy, nostalgic, you know, bulk items, the 21-color M&Ms, Jelly Bellies. We also offer
the bitter honeys.
Yeah, the nostalgic, the bitter honey, coconut long boys. But we also offer candy, apparel, accessories, and novelty items. So we carry a lot of Mars products like M&Ms.
Yes.
We carry Wonka, which is now Nestle. We carry a lot of their stuff. And then we carry some unnamed items, too. But you can come to our store and you can find candy throws or pillows, jewelry, bags, all different type of unique stuff.
Wow.
I really like the idea of candy having accessories and referring to it as confectionery, because that just makes me feel like I have taken it to a whole new level when I'm eating chocolate and jelly beans. There is a sophistication that has now entered my appreciation of candy that I frankly needed as a validation for my sweet tooth. So thank you. I'm very serious, because we think about, candy may seem frivolous,
right?
But there's a tremendous amount of manufacturing that goes on in that industry to be able to make sure that that product is there for Sharon to sell.
But I think it's so interesting what you talk about, Sharon and Christy. Christy, what you just said, candy is a very unique product. And I think it's become commoditized because it being, accessible through your Walgreens, through your CVS pharmacies, through, retail stores, instead of having that one focus like you have on not just, the popular candy items, but the nostalgic items, and then surrounding it, like you said, Christy.
The experience.
The whole experience with walking into a shop.
Yeah, because we wanted to make sure that we had items that you couldn't find at your Walgreens and CVS and Walmarts, but we want to make sure we had some of those items too. So, just something for everyone. But also the candy novelty items, you don't find that at any place unless you're going to like an amusement park or you go into some of the theme parks in Florida or a tourist area. So
do you have regulars?
We do have regulars. We have repeat customers every week, and we really appreciate their support.
That's great. I love that. It also means that people see the importance of having that indulgence in their life, because we also get so focused on making sure we're eating the right things and moving our bodies, which is really, really important. But I also think having that special thing that sets your day in motion is really
and
cool.
And we don't even look at them as regulars anymore. Now we've built friendships with those guys. So they come in and we know their families.
Right.
They bring their families into us that's traveling from out of town or whatnot. So we're building a lot of friendships with all these customers, with our customers.
In addition to your husband, are your children involved in the business as well?
Yes. We named the store after our daughters, Megan and Morgan. And we started them from the beginning. We sat down at the table. We came up with the logo. Morgan, by trade, she's my youngest. She's very artistic. She can draw, sing. She's just a very talented young girl. So we worked together, and she kind of drew up the ideal of the logo. Then we went and had that done. But we took them down to us to apply for the business license.
That's great.
To do everything. So they were involved.
So they were exposed to how you start a business.
They were exposed. And Morgan wants to be an entrepreneur. Megan is my oldest daughter, and we named the store after the M&Ms come from Megan and Morgan. But we also have two older kids, Darian, who has two masters, and he's working on his teacher certificate. He's an administrative at a university. And then Danielle Echols has her master's in HR, and she works for the state, but she does a lot of the marketing for us. Mm-hmm. Megan is still in school, and she actually works at the Del Mar store, kind of manages that. Mm-hmm. And then Morgan is in college also, and she manages the grand store for us.
Wow, that's great. It's a family business.
It's
then.
A family business. But with the grand location, our cousins partner with us.
Now tell us about the expansion, mm-hmm. because our listeners don't know that after, 5 years now in business, you guys are expanding to another location.
We did. Well, it was really nice that Vince Shamble kind of reached out to us about coming into the Grand Center area, and we mm-hmm. talked to Marlene Davis, who was the older woman in that area. We were so pleased that they reached out to us and say, hey, you know, we would like to see Miss M's over here. So we looked at different areas over mm-hmm. there in the Grand Center and decided on that location. So it took us about a year to kind of work out the whole contract, but we got it done.
And that follows along with how you looked at your business as a destination, a point of destination, and being in areas that were points of destination.
Yeah, location is key. Mm-hmm. And with, just like in the Del Mar Loop, you have the Grand Center, so you have theaters over there like the Fox and Powell and mm-hmm. Jazz Bistro. You got St. Louis University, mm-hmm. Harris Stowe. So we wanted to be in an area where we can get that same type of foot traffic.
That's wonderful. What were some of the obstacles that, as you guys were building your business early in the early days, what were some of those challenges and obstacles that you faced, both professionally and personally, as you started your business?
Well, it's tough, you know, and then I've never worked in retail before, nor have I ever owned a business before, so it was trial and error for all of us, you know.
A real new
experience.
I've
always been in banking because I started off in the Banking Work City program mm-hmm. in high school and went through out. So I've never worked in retail, so it was different. You know, we had our challenges as far as making sure we had payroll, mm-hmm. you know, had money to pay the rent, you know, because you never knew what the next day was going to bring.
And you brought a lot of thorough investigation mm-hmm. into the process. You talked about doing the foot traffic, really mm-hmm. understanding your location, really understanding your product. I imagine that that also went into other parts of the business as well
and
helped mitigate mm-hmm. some of that, but there's always a level of uncertainty.
Yeah, there is. And, you know, we wanted to make sure that we had a rent that we knew that was affordable, so if we didn't make the sales that out of our paychecks, if we had to pay it, we could, you know, and it wouldn't be a strain on us.
Your background leverages understanding the financials, right, behind a business. So I'm sure having that rigor in your background helped you manage through those early days.
Yeah, yeah. And then we also learned that, you know, we didn't need as many people. When we first started out, we had maybe one or two too many people, mm-hmm. you know, which we didn't need that, you know. So it was trial and error, you know. Mm-hmm. We learned from what we did at Del Mar, and we've taken it over here to the Grand
That's
location.
That's great. So do you have, besides family members, do you have any outside employees that work with your organization?
Right now it's just family. Mm-hmm. We are looking to hire outside at some point. Mm-hmm. You know, we would prefer to have college students, so we'll reach out to SLU and Harris Stowe, mm-hmm. someone that may be looking for to work within their work study program. Mm-hmm. So at the Grand location, it's my husband and I, Lee Echols and Sharon, and mm-hmm. then our two daughters, Megan and Morgan. Then we have Chelsea. Well, she's outside the family, but she's like a family.
Of course, yeah.
And then Robin and Guy Jenny. Robin mm-hmm. is my cousin. She's a flight attendant. And then Guy works, he's a captain at the fire department. So we all kind of pulled together, and we figured that we wanted someone to partner with us at mm-hmm. this Grand location because we knew we wanted to take it to the next level. Mm-hmm. So we host events at that location. We want to expand on our candy catering, which we do a lot of that. Mm-hmm. And we just wanted to be able to do more things, and we knew that we needed help to do that.
That's phenomenal.
Well, the planning process, I think, not only in the beginning 5 years ago, but it continues through as you're doing different iterations of the business. Mm-hmm. So I want to take a quick break and then come back and talk more about candy catering, customized mm-hmm. gift baskets, mm-hmm. and sort of the different ways that you've iterated on your business since you opened.
Let's just take five and address this stress. Do you have difficulty sleeping at night? Do you harbor feelings of resentment or anger? Do you feel overwhelmed by too much to do and the inability to organize time effectively? Well, if you answered yes to two or more of these questions, you could use to reduce your stress. When we're experiencing too much lasting negative stress, we got to do something about it. The research is clear. Toxic stress is making us sick, but you can be alive and well. Find out more at aliveandwellstl.com.
Hi, I'm Devin Moody Graham. I am a small business advocate and urban strategist in entrepreneurship in New St. Louis and abroad. Founder of The Biz Spot, and entrepreneurially thinking to me is really taking that leap of faith to go and achieve things that are much bigger than yourself. Because if you can achieve it by yourself, it's not a big deal. So to create something that impacts other people, more people than yourself, and that will impact people long after you're gone.
We're back with Sharon Echols of Miss M's Candy, and we're talking about how she has grown her business since starting 5 years ago, most recently with an expansion to Grand Center, mm-hmm. but also a variety of different lines of business. And so, Sharon, can you tell us a little bit about candy catering?
Yeah, candy catering is when we go out and we set up a candy bar, candy buffet for different events, such as a wedding. It could be a corporate event. It could be a birthday party, bridal shower. We did have done bar mitzvahs, bat mitzvahs, several events. It can be theme related, color related. You know, you come in, we talk about what your event is going to entail, and then we pick out colors and candies, and we go from there.
How did you get into that? I mean, that is really a unique, I think, offering for a confectionery.
You know, I really don't know how I got into it, to be honest, because I've actually been doing that for about 10 years before we even open up the candy store, because we entertain a lot at home, and, you know, it was all about presentation. Mm-hmm. So just putting different things in pretty jars and decorating the table, I thought was really cool. But then we started doing that with candy.
Must have a cool house with with all the candy and containers around.
So, yes, that's a lot of fun.
That's great.
I love that you harken back to 10 years ago, mm-hmm. sort of knowing that you had different experiences that could inform your business today. Because a lot of times folks think that it all happens at once, mm-hmm. or they have to know it all in one fell swoop. But I really, listening to your story, it was about that hardcore planning, mm-hmm. visiting the location every day mm-hmm. for a year to see what that foot traffic looked like, having that financial services background mm-hmm. to be able to put into the mix, then knowing where your gaps were, mm-hmm. you know, retail, not your specialty. Mm-hmm. So getting more information about that, but then also being able to look at your personal life and say, candy catering is a natural extension mm-hmm. of the entertaining I already do in my everyday life. That's something that I think people don't often weave together in that way.
Absolutely. And I think learning, one of the things that you talked about, which a lot of times it takes people a lot longer to understand some of the issues that you talked about. You had too many people in the store early on, and recognizing that and adjusting for that in order to make sure that your business stayed viable. And I think also, too, looking at how can we move to the next level? How do we expand? Because a lot of times we get comfortable. We're in a startup or in a business that's working, and we're thinking, oh, you know what? This works for
me.
Not
too bad.
Yeah. But looking at the scalability of that business, and I think that's what's so impressive, especially with a unique business model that you have.
Yeah. And, you know, we have a really great team because my husband, he's always thinking about what can we do next? What can we do next? Mm-hmm. And I know he's working on a reality show. You know, he really want to get that going. And then Danielle, you know, like my oldest daughter, she's always thinking, you know, let's do this and let's do that, you know, and she's so outgoing mm-hmm. and she's very aggressive and love the store that she's always pushing it. So that's what you really need.
That's great. You got an involved family.
Yeah.
How do you manage that though too? Maybe some family members wanting to go hard and fast on a new opportunity and others wanting to step back. I mean, whether you're related to them or not, partners can always have different mm-hmm. visions of where a company can go and how fast it should move.
Yeah. And that's a challenge because we know how we got to where we are today, mm-hmm. you know, and we don't want to deviate from that. And then sometimes people want to come in and they have a different mindset on how things should go. Well, this is how we made it to where we are today. We want to keep that and we want to grow on that, not mm-hmm. change the scope.
Right.
Because we are a candy store and we want to be the ultimate sweet shop mm-hmm. at some point. I love Crown Candy. I admire them, mm-hmm. you know, and I would like to be the Crown Candy of Grand Center in the Del Mar Loop at mm-hmm. some point.
That's wonderful.
Yeah. Are you guys looking at the next expansion?
We actually are. We've and our name had been mentioned at one location that we've been actually talking about for the last 2 years. Mm. I don't want to throw any names out there yet, but we're excited about it. And we heard that a meeting took place in the city. Mm-hmm. And our name came up because I had been talking to this individual about maybe opening up a location there. Mm-hmm. So if we get that spot, that would be the last location that we'll do in St. Louis.
Are you looking outside of St. Louis?
At some point. But, you know, there are so many candy stores. I'm not going to say exactly like ours, mm-hmm. but there are so many candy stores in all these other surrounding cities, mm-hmm. you know, that it just kind of depends on the location.
Okay.
We know about all of them because we travel a lot, mm-hmm. so we know what's happening in the different areas.
Could you see yourself stepping outside of candy retail now that you've really got a grasp on this entrepreneur thing?
You know, I don't think so. I really like it. Yeah.
I like that too. Mm-hmm. And your daughter, you said your daughter has entrepreneurial mm-hmm. aspirations.
Yeah, my youngest daughter, Morgan, she does. And she really enjoys working at the store. And she's going to school for business and music.
Oh, great.
With the emphasis on art. But she's very creative mm-hmm. and has a lot of creative thinking when it comes to that store. And she's been very helpful with a lot of the events that we plan.
And I think that's what we're always talking about here in our format with entrepreneurial thinking. It's how do you think differently? How do you envision your business? It all came to you with an idea with candy. So, you know, I think that's an inspiration to many of our listeners who sometimes think, you know, where do I start? How do I take this leap of faith? And I think you're demonstrating, you know what? You're able to take that leap of faith and move it forward. And now you're in your second location. We're waiting to hear about the third one. What would you like to, from an advice standpoint, for those people who are not sure about, you know, their next move, if they want to stay in corporate or should they take that leap, what would your advice be to those listeners?
Well, at some point, I would like to leave corporate America. You know, mm-hmm. when you own your own business, it's just a feeling you can't mm-hmm. describe. And I come from an entrepreneurial family. Mm-hmm. My brother has his own photography studio and has done that for years. Mm-hmm. Probably 25 to 30 years.
Wow.
And my uncles have all owned their own businesses too.
So you come from a line of entrepreneurs then.
But I never really thought at that point that I would want to own my own business until I started working in that capacity to mm-hmm. where I was managing people. I'm like, well, this is like my own business and I would like to at some point do something different mm-hmm. to be able to fall back on in the event that I get laid off. Mm-hmm. Sure enough, I got laid off. And so now, if that ever happens again, this gives us the perfect opportunity to open up a business, to grow it so that we can position ourselves to fall back on that mm-hmm. if something was to occur. So I would recommend, first of all, make sure you do your research. You know, make sure that you're financially stable, that your home is right. You know, mm-hmm. don't put yourself in a bind, you know, mm-hmm. to where you are caught off guard in certain situations. And location is key.
And 5 years in, you're still balancing, still being in the mortgage industry while running the store, planning the expansion. Mm-hmm. Time is always very precious. How do you balance all of those things?
We have no time because I never sleep, and I am a night owl. My husband said I'm extremely hyper. It may not seem like it, but I do think that I probably am because I stay up late, you know. And I stay in corporate America because I actually like what I do.
Well, that's a hallmark, I think, of many entrepreneurs. You know, we don't sleep. We have ideas always running through our heads, and you're trialing and testing those ideas all the time.
And
so.
It sounds like you're actually getting energized by the work you're doing in your corporate America job mm-hmm. to then take that forward into the business. So
exactly.
One is actually feeding the other rather than feeling drained by it. Mm-hmm. So I think that's important too, because we also assume that there has to be a point where you just draw the line and go in 110% into the entrepreneurship space.
But see, we know that at some point we are going to have to do that.
Mm-hmm. You know? But 5 years in, that's pretty impressive, actually.
5 years in and two locations.
Yeah, that you've actually been able to maintain that balance. Not only has that worked for you and your mm-hmm. family, mm-hmm. but it's also worked for your business.
Yes.
I would say that's very special.
Right, right. And I think exposing your children to a lifestyle that you were exposed to growing up in a family of entrepreneurs is also important. important because mm-hmm. it sets in the minds of children and teens, you know, young adults that, you know what, the sky is the limit. You can work in corporate or you can build your own or you can do both.
Yeah, yeah, there's no right way or wrong way.
Right.
That's also what I think. I think folks get stuck into thinking, well, the right way to do it is to leave my job and give it 110% and give everything it takes. And if it doesn't work, then it's not meant to be kind of thing.
Exactly.
But your story tells me that there's not only not one way of doing it right, but that what works for you mm-hmm. Could be replicable for others, but also their path might look very different.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Mm-hmm.
And that's inspiring. I think that knowing that you're... the family dynamic piece as well is not something everybody gets to integrate into the work that they're doing, but you guys have been really successful at that.
We have, and you know, they call me mean sometimes. That's okay, but I come from a large family, so family is very important to us. And then I get the experience also because it was 15 of my mother. I'm the youngest of six. I have 68 first cousins and 72 second cousins.
Wow.
You've
got a built-in corporation.
Yeah, we
do. Well, she has built-in customer base.
That's right, too.
And you're right. This year, we celebrated our 66th family reunion.
Oh, wow.
We do that every year. And I've hosted many of our reunions, you know, in other locations. So that kind of gives me the opportunity with the, you know, to have the experience with the events and things like that. Because you're coordinating a weekend with 200 people.
Right.
You know, so that kind of give me that little bit of experience to host
wonderful.
The events.
And I think what was very interesting, what you said, is that, you know, I'm assuming it's you and your husband are the CEOs of this enterprise, correct? Mm-hmm. So you guys are the decision makers of what goes on. You listen to feedback from family, but you guys make the decisions about the organization. Because I think that can be difficult in family businesses.
That's very important.
Most definitely.
But we most definitely listen to feedback from our customers. Mm-hmm. You know, that's where we get inspiration as to what we should do and what we should bring into the store. So we didn't go into the grand store with a massive line of products because we really didn't know, even though we worked at the demo store for 5 years, we didn't know which direction we wanted to go. Mm-hmm. It was still trial and error because we wanted to keep it as just a fine dine candy store. But when you see the demographics, we figure in the schools, we needed to have that traditional candy in there too.
To make sure what trends are you seeing now? Listening to your customers, do you see any new candy trends that we should be aware of?
Well, you know, at the grand location, most people are more so interested in our bulk items and then the nostalgic candy. So but they love the chocolate. We carry pastries. You know, we're going to be carrying ice cream next year.
Oh my God, I'll be there.
Yes.
We'll be introducing wine because we'll do
I'll be there too.
And chocolate pairing.
I think that's a beautiful marriage.
Yes.
Next fall, we're going to introduce beer and nut pairing.
Interesting.
So we'll bring all of that in. So we have things, you know, down the road what we want to do at that location.
That is very cool, Sharon. I mean, this is so exciting. And I think, like you're right, I haven't seen this in the city. And I haven't seen this in other cities either, especially with the offerings that that you guys are going to be adding. So I think that's going to be a very distinctive offering and opportunity for people to engage with Miss M's.
Yeah, we're excited.
Yes.
Well, I'm excited to watch you grow.
Yes.
To learn more about what it means to successfully pair my candy and my wine together and my nuts and my beer, because I think the possibilities are endless after that, and it hits that sweet salty thing that totally works for me. So I know that our listeners will also be looking to make sure that they're following you as well. Can you tell us exactly where in Del Mar and on Grand that we can find you so that those who want to check out your offerings can do so with ease?
Yeah, so in the Del Mar Loop, we're located at 6193 Del Mar, right at the corner of Del Mar and Skinker. We're right next door to the Pinup Bowling Alley. And then the Grand Center, we're located at 500 North Grand, Unit 1F. We're right on the corner of Grand and Olive, and we're directly across the street from Big Brothers Big Sisters.
Fantastic.
That's great.
So now
that's
we know where to find you so we can get our candy and maybe a few words of wisdom from a seasoned entrepreneur as well, if you're lucky. So I want to thank you again, Sharon, for joining us.
Thanks for having me.
For being part of the conversation and really for opening up our thinking in terms of what's possible and how we can pursue our dreams.
Thank you very much.
And sharing your dream here with the St. Louis Market. We're so excited and happy that you're here.
Thank you. Thank you.
Time for some candy.
Yes, and ice cream.
Okay.
Changing the way you view new ventures, igniting your thinking about entrepreneurship. It's entrepreneurially thinking. Get connected and discover more. Visit our website for show notes, resources, information about our guests, upcoming events, and of course, all your favorite episodes. If you have any questions, be sure to leave them for us in the comment sections. And be sure to leave us a 5-star rating on iTunes. The best way to show love is to share. Let everybody know that you're thinking entrepreneurially. So visit our website, entrepreneurallythinking.com. Hashtag ethinkstl. Entrepreneurially Thinking is another positive production of RareGem Productions. Thanks for listening.